Sinner's Prayer 2 begins on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his name, now and forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Let your continual mercy, O Lord, cleanse and defend your church. And because it cannot continue in safety without your help, protect and govern it always by your goodness, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
A child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and fed them. They shall return to the land of Egypt and Israel, and shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oracle priests and devours because of their schemes. My people are bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call, but he does not raise them up at all. How can I give up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Adma? How can I treat you like Zebulun? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God and no mortal, Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. They shall go after the Lord, who roars like a lion. When he roars, his children shall come trembling from the west. They shall come trembling like birds from Egypt, and like doves from the land of Syria. And I will return them to their homes, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 107. 1-9 and 4-3 verses. Okay. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Let all those whom the Lord has redeemed proclaim. He gathered them out of the lands,
from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south.
Some wandered in desert wastes.
They found no way to the city where they might dwell.
They were hungry and thirsty.
Their spirits languished within them.
Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble,
and he delivered them from their distress.
He put their feet on a straight path,
for those who see where they might dwell.
Let them give thanks to the Lord for his mercy,
and the wonders he does for his children.
satisfies the thirsty.
Fills the hungry with good things.
Now, verse 43. Whoever is wise will ponder these things.
And consider the mercies of the Lord.
The word of the Lord.
Reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And Christ, who is your life, is revealed. Then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever is in you is earthly: fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life. But now you must get rid of all such things: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices, and have clothed yourselves with the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free, but Christ is all and in all. The word of the Lord.
Judge or arbitrator over you. And he said to them, take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, what should I do, for I have no place to store my crops? Then he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
Gracious God, open our hearts and our minds to receive that which you have for us this day. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. One of the fun things about coming to church and using the lectionary, you just never know until it gets there when you're going to get readings that have fornication in them. Or whoredom, I think, was last week. Yeah. Ooh, twice, three times last week. The Bible can be racy. But given that, our letter to Colossians today, I wanted to dig in a little bit beyond, don't be scared by all the paper that I have here. It's mostly my thinking. I wanted to dig a little beyond just looking at the base sentences of what we're being told to put away in order to move into our life in Christ. And even a little bit more about what some of the intentions behind it are. Now, we read this as though it's a letter from Paul, but there is some dispute as to whether or not Paul was actually the one who wrote it, or if it's someone who followed in the wake of Paul and wrote a lot like Paul. But like all the letters, the goal of this letter to the Colossians is to address something happening in their community that the letter writer hopes, in the spirit of being the church, can be rectified before it gets out of hand. So in our reading, we have put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly. Fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. Getting into each of these, the Greek and from which they come, they all point to the similar kind of thing, which is rooted in idolatry, which is rooted in seeing things on this earth as greater than that to which we are called in our life in Christ. And I particularly find it interesting, one of the, passion is in the next one, I think. Passion. One of the things for passion is not so much being over exuberant about things, but it's about giving ourselves over to being embedded in our suffering, to being caught up in our suffering, the negative aspects, to not be able to see what is around us because all we can see is how we suffer. I found that interesting. And then moving on in the letter, on account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life.
But now you must get rid of all such things, anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Where the first were really pointing to idolatry and the valuing of things earthly over things of God, this part is really getting to how we interact with those around us, how we treat our family, our friends, our neighbors, those who are different from us, those who are so similar to us that sometimes we can't stand it. The abusive language is also translated as filthy communication. We put that in context. So do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourselves with the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free, but Christ is all and in all. Baptism. This is calling us into what we are baptized into. That when we become baptized, we are experiencing a renewal in the image of our Creator. And in that renewal, the divisions cease to be real. The divisions cease to exist. This is calling us to account for the ways that we have divided ourselves and humanity that are false. Because at the end of the day, if we are all made in the image of God, it's really hard to say, you are not like me, therefore, you are not worthy. You are a lower class, or even you are a higher class, and I am not worthy. These are false divisions that we have created. The participation of the faithful, of those of us who are leaning into our baptismal covenant, not only transforms us, but has the power to transform the whole community. We could see that here as the community of St. George's, and then out of that, the community around us. And if we look and we watch and we think about how we've seen things play out over the past several years or our lifetimes, we can see how one powerful person, like Gandhi or Dr. Martin Luther King, they have the power to lead entire groups of people for positive change and justice and good and equality. And then we can also see groups around people like Hitler, who can lead entire groups of people into evil. One person on each. So what does it take if we become to be transformed? How can we then influence the transformation of the community around us toward what is good and holy? And that doesn't mean everybody has to believe the way we do. But at the root of it, even those who don't believe in God and want nothing to do with the church, at their heart, they often want the same things we do. Our self-understanding is constantly being renewed. Our understanding of our relationships with each other is constantly being renewed. And this really, Colossians, it's an extended commentary on the claim that Paul and those who follow Paul have, that Christ is the wisdom and power of God. Because those of us who are baptized, we are baptized into the death and resurrection of Christ, this Jesus who we listen to every Sunday, and for those of us who study through the week, that is what we are baptized into, the power and the wisdom that can often be seen as foolishness because, gosh, does it really seem so simple? The Colossians were facing temptation to give in to some of the ways that the society around them were being at that time, which was leading into that division. And so this letter was calling them back in. And as I was preparing for this, I couldn't help but think about the Lambeth Conference, which is taking place right now. For those of you who don't know, the Lambeth Conference is a gathering of bishops from the entire Anglican Communion around the world that happens approximately every 10 years. The last one was in 2008. This one, of course, got a little delayed, first by arguments and division, and then by a pandemic. But now that it is happening, the arguments and division are back in full display. And as I listen to this letter from Colossians and I think about the message it's giving to the community, and I look at this gathering at Lambeth, this is the first year that LGBTQ-identified bishops were invited. The last time, Gene Robinson was the only one, and he was not invited. Thomas, of course, our bishop, is one of them, and he was invited, but his spouse, their spouses, were not. And though this is not a voting conference, it was put on the table to once again have the Anglican Communion dehumanize LGBTQ people. And though great strides across the communion from countries all over the world, bishops representing people all over the world came out and said, this is not okay, there was still a group so solidly in it that they worked to convince people not to take communion alongside partnered gay and lesbian bishops. How might this letter from Colossians reach them? Can you imagine having so much hatred in your heart that you would sit out here and say, I will not take communion because so-and-so is up there and I don't agree with so-and-so and I don't think that they're right? That's hatred. When Jesus calls us into communion, into community, this letter reminds us that Jesus showed us that there are no divisions. Again and again, he called those who were othered in, and he called those who oppressed in. Jesus was constantly calling in and calling us to find a way to see that we are all made in the image of God. How might we be a part of the transformation that could have the potential, even here in our country, to lead us to the end of some of the division and violence and hatred that has taken such root here? How might we hear this letter from the Colossians and take to heart what we are being called to put away because we've been baptized and renewed in the image of our Creator, who is in all and loves all? I know I'll be praying on that. And as I look out at you, these faithfully gathered on Sunday, and I think about the journey we've been on these past few years, and I think about what's facing churches across the board right now, my heart yearns for how we can rekindle the spirit of coming together with love as our root and our guide. How we can rekindle the spirit of putting away the idolatry of things such as hatred and envy and anger and malice. How we can move away from abusive language and poor treatment of others and return to the goodness and the love of which and in which we are created. Jesus reminds us that we don't need to put things away for later, because later is not always guaranteed. I know that I'm not always the best about reaching out when I think about it. But that's one of those things we can work on too, because it's not guaranteed that whoever we've been thinking about will be there tomorrow or the next day or the next. And relationships are just as valuable as these crops that we might build up and store away to make sure that we have abundance later. But if we build on our relationships and we share in the abundance Christ provides for us, and we live here and now, not only destined for some heavenly goal, but living into how we can be heaven here on earth, that would be a very good thing.
Please stand as you are able. Let us affirm our faith by saying together the Nicene Creed on page 358. We believe.
Prayers of the People of Form 6, found on page 392. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God, all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are vulnerable,
for this community, the nation, and the world,
for all who work with justice, freedom, and peace,
for the just and proper use of your creation,
for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression,
for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble,
for those who minister to the sick, the friends, and the needy,
for the peace and unity of the Church of God,
for all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
Michael, our presiding bishop, Thomas, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers,
all who serve God in this church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
We pray for all who are on our St. George's prayer list and those who have asked for our prayers. We pray for our presiding bishop Michael and our bishop Thomas and all the bishops gathered at Lambeth.
Hear us, Lord.
Your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life.
We give you thanks for this congregation gathered here present and those with us online. We give you thanks for the abundance of your love that is present in your people.
We will exalt you, O God, our King.
Praise your name forever.
Pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Lord, they trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, now and unknown, things done and left undone.
And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the midst of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Sunday of July, holy cow. What? School begins in a few weeks. What?
Really?
The only reason I mention that is because I want to make sure we get it on our calendars for those of you who, God bless you for teaching, for those of you who work in schools, and for students of any age, on August 21st, I think it is, the second to last Sunday in August, right before the teachers will go back, we will be doing blessings for back to school. So we want to bless you and send you off with goodness into the year ahead. And I promise I won't say anything. We have a few more opportunities for folks to join me for Holy Hikes. There's one more paddle with the pastor. We've had some fun with that. The hike this week is a bit more, it's rated moderate. It's not a stroll through the woods. There's some up and downs, so keep that in mind. both for your footwear and your abilities. Still looking for suggestions on a women's gathering. I've heard from a couple of you. Would love to hear from a couple more if you're interested in this, whether brunch or tea, here or elsewhere, sounds appealing. So holler at us. Jumble sale, this is the big one. We do have a sign-up sheet in the back. If you are able to show up and help, I already put my name down. We'll love to see yours join me. It's gonna be a great opportunity not only to raise a little money for the church, but also to spend some time together. Joshing around and also seeing what treasures people find that we maybe thought was trash. We scooped some great stuff in the basement that we're gonna put out. Sounds scary because it's the basement, but these are some great items, like some old wicker chairs that could be turned into neat plant potters. Pot holders. Thank you, Sarah. So get on the sign-up sheet, come out and see us, especially if you haven't been around lately. Come by, see what we've got. It's gonna be a great day. And also just pray for the rain.
To stay away,
thank you. Pray for a nice, good, clear, semi-cool, semi-warm day to have a good jumble. Let's see, what else? Parish picnic. The last Sunday in August, we're gonna have a parish picnic. Again, a celebration of coming together, remembering the anniversary of when this church was founded, which was in August of 1906. We've been around for a while, y'all. We're gonna have some food. The church will provide hamburgers and hot dogs. Make sure you make note of what you want. There's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board out here. You can put down what food you're bringing, your delicious dish, and whether you're into hamburgers, hot dogs, or veggie dogs. I'm bringing cornhole. Please bring other lawn games and we can get some friendly competition going on. I won't promise to beat you. I'm not actually that good. And then just the continuing reminder for coffee hour that all are welcome to bring goodies for coffee hour and help out there. Let's not leave it to just a few, to all of us to enjoy on Sundays. Yes, Sarah.
Just in relation to the jumbo.
So listen to Sarah for the time to come Christ. And there is a spot to sign up to help with that on the sheet.
Right.
And set up and clean up and all that. And men's breakfast, August 20th, 8 a.m. at the Hen House. Anything I'm missing? Oh, National Night Out, August 9th, which is a Tuesday. At Central Park. So go out and meet some of our first responders, get to know them, and make sure to say thank you for the services they provide for our community.
Men's breakfast.
I got that one. Apparently I didn't say it loud enough. Men's breakfast, August 20th, 8 a.m. in the house. Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and give ourselves an offering of sacrifice and praise.
Thank you.
prayer A begins on page 361. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Creator Almighty, God of heaven and earth, for you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever say this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of fire and light, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ is alive.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And in the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
stand or kneel as you are able. Post-communion prayer is on page 366. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with spiritual food, the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and the heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do. We love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And may God, who created you in love and for love, bless you now and always in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So do we have any birthdays or anniversaries to pray for? Okay, I guess it was all right then. Oh, no. I thought you were waving your hand to dismiss. Then let us pray, page 830. Oh, diaconal ordinance. That's right. Jean was ordained to the diaconate. Was
August 1st.
August
1st. August
1st.
August 1st. Yes.
August 1st, August 8th. So let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for our deacon, Jean, for her ministry in our church and in the world, and for the gift that she has been to this community. All of this we pray as we bless her in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Oh, that's right. Charge? Let us go now with love in our hearts into the world.
Thanks be to God.